The calculus topic of optimization tries to maximize or minimize a quantity subject to certain constraints. Now, when we first see the words maximize and minimize here, our mind immediately goes to extrema, and that is very closely tied to what we're going to use to solve these optimization problems. We remember relative maxes and mins, or what are called local maximums and minimums, from an earlier video. So the idea behind optimization is you might have a quantity like volume of a box, let's say, or volume of a sphere, or profits, where you might try to maximize your profits in a business or minimize your cost in a business, or on and on and on. There's so many different examples, but we're going to try to optimize this quantity subject to certain constraints. So just as a simple example, maybe we're looking at the volume of a box. Now, just based off of these words, maximize and minimize, what you might think we would do is you would look at either the graph or the function that pertains to volume. And then if you graphed it, you would be able to either see or find, for instance, a relative maximum of the function. And that's a great idea. And if we could do that, we certainly would do that. But there's one main hang up for all optimization problems. You can open up your calculus book and look at every example in the optimization section, and they'll all have the same issues. They can be totally different types of examples, but they all have the same main problem, and here's what it is. The problem for these optimization problems is the quantity we want to optimize is going to have too many variables. So I'm going to illustrate this point with a classic example. This example is in most calculus textbooks. The problem is you have a square piece of cardboard paper, and I wrote 18 inches, but it could be 24 or 12 inches. It doesn't matter the size. And they're going to get you to cut corners out of the pieces of cardboard to where you can fold up the tabs and make a box. And the goal is to find the size cutouts of the corners that would maximize the volume of the box. Seems pretty simple, but when you think about it, if you make too small of a cut, you'll have a very flat box because you have very small tabs to fold up on the sides and it won't hold a lot of water. Or if you cut out corners that are too big, then the sides will be too small and the will be too large and the base will be too small and you won't have a lot of volume. But there should be some healthy balance in the middle that will maximize or give you the most volume, more so than any other cut. Now, when you start thinking through the math, you start thinking, okay, what's the volume of a box? What do you think? Length times width times height. Well, hopefully that right there shows you or helps you understand that this idea of graphing volume and looking for a relative maximum like you were hoping to do isn't going to work, because what would the independent variable be? Volume depends in this example on the length, the width, and the height of the box. Now, here's where the constraint comes into play. We thought the constraint would be something that makes this problem harder, this constraint. It actually turns out to help us, believe it or not, because the constraint makes these things interdependent on one another. For instance, if you only had so much cardboard, for instance, as the length and width of the box get larger, then the height would have to get smaller, to compensate because you only have so much cardboard, etc. So let's go back up here, and I'm not going to finish this example, but my goal in this video is just to kind of give you the idea behind optimization. If you had a piece of cardboard that was 18 inches by 18 inches, a square piece of cardboard, then what's varying is the size of the cut. So I'll say X. So I'm cutting out X by X squares. Now let's look at this box here and see if we can think of what the length, the width, and the height will be in terms of the size cutouts. Well, we'll start with the height. If you can look at this box here, what I just drew here in orange, that's going to be the base of the box. And right here that I'm putting dashes, the thing I'm putting dashes on, that's going to be the tabs that would fold up. So hopefully it's pretty clear to you that the height of the box will be X, because however tall this is when you fold it up vertically. That'll be how tall the X is. All right, now, how long and wide is this box that holds water? Well, the hold distance was 18 inches, but do you realize if you cut out X and X away from the full sheet of cardboard, the length would be 18 minus 2X. And since it's a square box, the width would also be 18 minus 2X. So you see what you can do here, and this is the key step. And if you get this, then you should be able to do most any optimization problem. The volume can now be written not as length times width times height with three separate variables, but 18 minus 2x times 18 minus 2x times x. So all three are in terms of a single variable. And that's the key step. Once you've reduced the number of variables from a lot down to just one independent variable, then you can proceed like normal. The volume at the end of the day is really just a function of the size cutouts that you're making. It's really just a function of x. So if you have a function of x, then you can take the derivative of v with respect to x and, see what that is and set it equal to zero, find your critical points, find out where it's increasing and decreasing, and do all the things that you know how to do, and that will reveal where the maximum volume is. Now, the last thing I'll say is that your answer that you'll get in this particular problem will be x equals blank, but you have to make sure to answer the question as they ask. For instance, for this problem, they would likely ask, what would the dimensions of the box be that gives the maximum volume? Which would require just a little bit of extra work where you would actually go back and find the actual length, width, and height specifically. Now, I know I kind of glazed through this example. In the next video, we're actually going to go through a full-blown example and actually do the math, all the way out. But hopefully, this is just a good introduction to how to work optimization problems. So, just in closing, let me just give you this quick little rundown list. So, steps to solve optimization problems. Step one, find some equation that relates all the quantities that you have. If they're asking for volume, find a volume equation. If they want profit, find a profit equation. Area, et cetera, et cetera. Now, the consistent thing in all these optimization problems is that equation will typically have too many variables. So next, number two, use the constraint that you're given to reduce the number of variables. Knock it from three independent variables down to one, or two to one, or five to one. And then it's like a normal Calc 1 problem. Find the maxes and mins using derivatives and critical points and increasing and decreasing intervals and all that good stuff that we know how to do. So anyways, hope that helps you understand optimization problems a little bit better. Watch my next video where we actually work through an example, an optimization problem, and you actually get to see some of the nuts and bolts of how you actually go through and work a problem.